Hello, my name is Dr. Colin Campbell. I am a research scientist here at Meter Group and also an adjunct professor at Washington State University, where I teach a class on environmental biophysics. And today we're going to be extending our discussion on humidity by talking about how, using a couple of common terms related to humidity, we can calculate vapor pressure. So the first one we're going to talk about is dew point temperature. And I've drawn a couple of figures here that illustrate a test that I actually did when I was a graduate student in a class related to biophysics. So the professor had us take a beaker of water and a thermometer that I'm showing here. And what we did was we put ice in this beaker and started to stir it with the thermometer. So we were rotating it around in the glass. And our job was to sit there and look very carefully and find out when a thin film of dew began to form around on the glass. So we watched the thermometer go down. So this is kind of what happened in time. The thermometer temperature dropped. And at some point, we observed a thin film that I've drawn right here form onto that glass. And at the point that the film began to form, we looked at the temperature, and we took from that this was the dew point temperature. And it means exactly what it says, the point at which dew began to form. Now, of course, this experiment wasn't perfect because there is certainly a temperature difference between the inside of our glass there, where we're stirring with the thermometer, and the outer surface of the glass. But it was a good approximation and a great way to demonstrate what dew point temperature is. So, as I mentioned, we can say that the dew point temperature is the point at which the air is saturated and water begins to condense out, which I'm saying over here in this little statement here. And so we call this, again, our TD, or our dew point temperature. And the beautiful thing about dew point temperature is that if you know this value, you can very easily calculate your vapor pressure, or even go on to calculating relative humidity, as I talked about in another lecture that you can look at. So to calculate our vapor pressure from our dew point temperature, all that we have to do, there's a value we want, vapor pressure of the air, we'll call that EA, and that is equal to the saturation vapor pressure at the dew point temperature here, ESTD. And again, like my other lecture, the saturation vapor pressure is a function of the temperature, not multiplied by the temperature. And I also talked about this in another lecture. It's pretty simple to get the saturation vapor pressure at the dew point temperature. We simply use Teton's formula, which says that the saturation vapor pressure at the dew point is just equal to 0.611 kilopascals times the exponential of BTD over C plus TD, so TD being the dew point temperature. And here are those constants that I was talking about right there. So let's do a quick example, just so we know how to do this, if you ever had to do it. Let's just assume that our dew point temperature was 5 degrees C. Now, this is something you can find in many weather reports if you look down the list of measurements carefully. It's usually there. So what is the vapor pressure of the air, EA? So the vapor pressure of the air would just be the saturation vapor pressure at the dew point temperature, and that dew point temperature is now 5 degrees, so EA is calculated by the formula I showed. And if we just, so there's 17.502, that's our first constant, B. Our second constant, C, is just 240.97, and then we have the dew point temperature here and here. And if we put that into our calculator, it ends up that our vapor pressure is 0.87 kilopascals. Now, there might be a variety of reasons we want this. Maybe we want to calculate the relative humidity from it, and then we simply divide that by the saturation vapor pressure at the air temperature. Then we'd have our relative humidity. Or more commonly, we use the EA and the saturation vapor pressure at the air temperature to calculate the vapor deficit. So in some maybe agronomic application, that might be interesting to us. So that is dew point temperature. Now let's go through and talk about another common measurement that we have, and that is our wet bulb temperature. This was much more common in past years where there really weren't electronic means to measure things like dew point or humidity sensors, and we used to have to make a measurement of humidity by hand. And what they did was they collected what they call a dry bulb temperature, or a standard air temperature. And that dry bulb temperature, or the temperature of the air, was compared to what they call a wet bulb temperature. And they made this wet bulb temperature by putting a cotton wick right here around the bulb on the thermometer. So they just put that on there. And this was just a fabric, and then we drip water on it. So let's get a little bit of water. We're going to drip a little bit of water down on here, and it's going to just fill up this wick and saturate it with water. And that's the condition I'm showing right here. Once that wick is saturated with water, the water begins to evaporate, and we use wind to essentially enhance that evaporation. So some instruments would just have a little fan inside that would blow water across this wick. Or more commonly, and maybe you've even seen this, you'd use a device, two temperature sensors that were attached on a rotating handle. So you'd spin these in the air. And if you could get them going about, they say, 1 meter per second, so 2 miles an hour in the spin, I don't know how you'd ever estimate that, but that was the goal. That would help the water evaporate at kind of an optimum level. And this evaporation, you can think of what's going to happen in this evaporation. Just as you may be climbing out of the pool, you feel that cooling, that as water begins to evaporate when you climb out of a pool on a dry, warm summer day, you'll feel that cooling at your surface. And that's water as it changes from liquid water into water vapor. And it actually releases energy, or it takes energy for this to happen, and the amount of energy it takes is 44 kilojoules per mole. So that's actually quite a bit of energy that's used in changing liquid water into water vapor. And when that happens, it decreases the temperature of this bulb over here that we're talking about. And when it decreases that temperature, essentially this temperature, the red part here, goes down. So when that happens, when that temperature decreases, we actually wait till we've kind of reached that maximum temperature decrease, and we take that as our wet bulb temperature, our TW. This wet bulb temperature is not quite as simple as our dew point temperature to use to make a calculation. Here's the calculation we need to estimate vapor pressure from the wet bulb temperature. So as you see here, what it says is that we take the saturation vapor pressure at the wet bulb temperature here and subtract off from that these three parameters, the gamma, which is the psychrometer constant, 6.66 times 10 to the negative 4th degrees Celsius to the negative 1 times the pressure of the air, and then finally multiplied by the difference between the air temperature, or that dry bulb that I mentioned earlier, and the wet bulb temperature. And so this gamma is an interesting number. It's actually the specific heat of air divided by the latent heat of vaporization, that 44 kilojoules per mole that I mentioned before, but we can simply take it as a constant for our purposes here of 6.66 times 10 to the negative 4 degrees C to the negative 1. So let's actually put this into a calculation here. So here the problem says, here's just an example. Okay, our example problem says, find the vapor pressure of the air if air temperature, TA, is 20 degrees Celsius, the wet bulb temperature, TW, is 11 degrees Celsius, and air pressure is 100 kilopascals. So we're basically at sea level. And just to remind us, this is the constant gamma, 6.66 times 10 to the negative 4 degrees C to the negative 1. Air pressure, we write here, 100 kilopascals. The dry bulb is 20 degrees Celsius, and the wet bulb is 11 degrees. And we take this standard equation that I showed up here and actually insert all these numbers into the equation. So our vapor pressure is going to be this calculation that came from Teton's formula that I showed earlier. And right here, we inserted 11 degrees C. Then we subtract off 6.66 times 10 to the negative 4, multiplied by 100 kilopascals, multiplied by the difference between the air temperature and wet bulb temperature. And if you go ahead and plug all those numbers into your calculator, and notice here that our degrees C, they cancel, and then we're just left with kilopascals, our vapor pressure is about 0.71 kilopascals. So that is how we calculate the vapor pressure from the wet bulb temperature. So I hope this has been interesting. These are values that you may find now. It's less common. We usually just get our relative humidity from a capacitance-based relative humidity sensor, but still people talk in terms of wet bulb and in terms of wet bulb temperature and dew point temperature. And it's interesting to understand how we actually calculate our vapor pressure from that. If you'd like to know more about this, please go to our website, metergroup.com, and just look around there. Look at some of the instruments that are there to make measurements. Or you can email me if you want to know more, colin.campbell@metergroup.com. And hope you have a great day.